Well, good morning and welcome all. Special welcome to you if you're a visitor with us this morning. There's no tea and coffee during this COVID period, but it's a good thing that we can practice hospitality, so you can be encouraged to be a part of that. There's no special notes this morning, but do bear in mind your newsletter there and the emails through the week. There's been some notices there. This morning, as we come to worship, we're led by our brother Bruce Hoyt, and we pray that you would be blessed in being able to worship and leading us in worship. Now, as we prepare our hearts, let's sing number 394, Glorious Things of Thee Are Spoken.
With the words that we sang, maybe it's almost a bit embarrassing because we were singing about ourselves. We are the Church of God, the City of Zion, and God has made us glorious. And we aren't exactly comfortable to say that about ourselves, are we? And yet it is the truth. God has bestowed his glory upon his people. And we need to reflect on that as we live in this world, because this world often looks down upon the church and regards it as worthless. But that's not God's view. And so let us bow before him, coming in a moment of silent prayer as we begin our worship. Hear us, Father, through Jesus our Lord, and grant that our worship may be acceptable to you through the work of Christ and by the operation of your Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Will the congregation rise? Brothers and sisters, we are called to worship with words from Psalm 87. On the holy mount stands the city he founded. The Lord loves the gates of Zion more than all the dwelling places of Jacob. Glorious things of you are spoken, O city of our God. We confess that our help is in the name of the Lord who made the heavens and the earth. And our God greets us through the words of the Apostle Paul, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And we'll praise the Lord as we turn to number 122, My Heart Was Glad, praising him who called us into his presence at this worship service this morning. To thee, my love, shall never be denied. We have committed ourselves. We have to ask then, how should we as God's people live? I'd ask you to turn with me to Ephesians chapter 4, reading these words inspired by God, which were written by the Apostle Paul. Ephesians chapter 4, I read verses 1 through 16. in view of what has been said in the first three chapters about the Church of God being his body and being called to serve him, then the apostle says, "I therefore, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope that belongs to your call. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But grace was given to each one of us according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore it says, when he ascended on high, he led a host of captives and gave gifts to men. In saying he ascended, what does it mean but that he had also descended into the lower regions, the earth? He who descended is the one who also ascended far above all the heavens, that he might fill all things. And he gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds and teachers to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for the building up of the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a mature manhood, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, so that we may no longer be children tossed to and fro by the waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by human cunning, by craftiness in deceitful schemes. Rather, speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and held together by every joint with which it is equipped, when each part is working properly, makes the body grow so that it builds itself up in love." We are members of the body of Christ, each called to use the gifts that God has given us in order that we might, as members, build up the body of Christ. This is the way God builds his church. And so we ought to thank him for the work that he has called us to do and joyfully participate in that together. And so I'd ask that we sing once again, turning to number 393, and commit ourselves to building up the church of God through our love and prayers.
Our Lord, the Church of God, spread spreading.
who's the duty elder this morning, will lead us in congregational prayer.
This morning, there's two collections which we'll also be remembering in prayer. There's one collection for the work of this church, and then there's also a collection for the work of the Open Home Foundation and the Crossroad Prison Ministries. And as usual, the boxes at the door, should you be giving to those things. Let's come to the Lord now in prayer. Our Lord and Father, we thank you that we can call you Father. You are our Father. You are near. You care for our worship. You care for the love of our hearts through worship. We know that you give us an audience in prayer, even though we are small and sinful people, because you are our Father and you have shown love to us in Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you for our parents and especially the fathers that you've given to each one of us. Many of them have been good examples and have led us to see something of who you are and of how we may be saved. We pray that you would bless those fathers among us, to lead their families well, to teach and to portray the good news of the gospel to their children. May the fathers among us reflect something of who you are as our Father, slow to anger, but abounding in loving kindness. Lord, we have heard about the cancer which Rosemary is suffering from, and we ask you that you would help her to be constant in faith. Be near her and give Roger and her your comfort. Lord, thank you for our Saviour, who suffered in his body and understands our trials. May we all look to you as one who knows our weaknesses and our trials. Lord, and we pray that you would give her healing, but work according to your will, we pray. And we know that you are greater than all of the circumstances of our lives. So as we all face difficulties, and our anxiety over tomorrow or next month, over the future of our income or our health, Lord, remind us to put our trust in you when we doubt. You are our Father, and you provide what we need. Lord, we pray also for a blessing on those who are expecting operations in the near future. Bless the work of the doctors, and we pray that you use these operations to heal them. And as each one of us struggles in some way with sin, Lord, help us to see our sin and work in us to get rid of the sin that still remains in us. Help us to put them to death, to be wholehearted in serving you. The sins of anger, of malice, of unthankful grumpiness and complaining, of sexual immorality, of laziness. Help us to see how wrong they are. Help us to see also and experience your full and free forgiveness in Jesus, our Saviour, and that we are freed from the guilt of sin by his suffering for us. Lord, we want, we desire, we thirst after many things in this life, but we pray that you satisfy us with yourself, that we wouldn't seek that satisfaction elsewhere. Lord, we thank you for your grace to us. Even when we were still living for sin, Christ died for us. Your grace to us was not something that we earned. We are not entitled to your goodwill towards us. So just as freely as we have received, open our hearts to freely give. Open for us opportunities to speak of the gospel to workmates and neighbors and tell them of the good news in Jesus Christ. Lord, we pray for the deacons and for their work in the church. Bless them and help them to be able to understand the needs and support them wisely. We pray for the Open Home Foundation for the prison Crossroad Prison Ministries. Lord, bless these works, and may the gospel also go out through them. We thank you also that the Vanderwells were able to return to Vanuatu to carry on their work in the church there. We pray for your blessing on that church in Vanuatu and the families involved, and that the preaching of your word would fall on listening ears and eager hearts, and that you would be glorified through their work. We thank you also that we can anticipate now the ordination of Abel as an elder. Lord, bless him in this work that he looks to take up. Bless him that he may be a blessing to us as a congregation. Lord, in all that we pray, we commit ourselves to you, our faithful Father, knowing that you hear us. In Jesus we pray. Amen.
Once again, let us praise the Lord. He is the one who defends his church and causes her to grow both in number and faithfulness and also in beauty. And so we'll stand as we sing Psalm 48, number 48, the verses 1, 2, 5, and 6. We turn again in the Word of God now to Matthew chapter 10. The Lord Jesus is in the process of urging his disciples to to consider the future opposition that they will find as they go out into this world. He sends them out on a missionary journey, as it were, teaching them the way that they should carry the gospel. But these words also apply to the church down through the ages. And the Lord Jesus warns us that there is trouble ahead for God's people. And so we read beginning at verse 16 down through verse 33. Behold, I am sending you out as sheep in the midst of wolves, so be wise as serpents and innocent as doves. Beware of men, for they will deliver you over to the courts and flog you in their synagogues, and you will be dragged before governors and kings for my sake, to bear witness before them and the Gentiles. When they deliver you over, do not be anxious how you are to speak or what you are to say, for what you are to say will be given to you in that hour. For it is not you who speak, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. Brother will deliver brother over to death, and the father his child, and children will rise against parents and have them put to death, and you will be hated by all for my name's sake. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. When they persecute you in one town, flee to the next, for truly I say to you, you will not have gone through all the towns of Israel before the Son of Man comes. A disciple is not above his teacher, nor a servant above his master. It is enough for the disciple to be like his teacher, and the servant to be like his master. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebub, how much more will they malign those of his household? So have no fear of them, for nothing is covered that will not be revealed, or hidden that will not be known. What I tell you in the dark, say in the light. And what you hear whispered, proclaim on the housetops. And do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather fear him who can destroy both body and soul in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? And not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. But even the hairs of your head are all numbered. Fear not, therefore, you are of more value than many sparrows. So everyone who acknowledges me before men, I will also acknowledge before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, I also will deny before my Father who is in heaven. And now let us turn to Hebrews chapter 11. I read beginning at verse 8 down through verse 28. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to a place that he was to receive as an inheritance. He went out, not knowing where he was going. By faith, he went to live in the land of promise, as in a foreign land, living in tents with Isaac and Jacob, heirs with him of the same promise. For he was looking forward to the city that has foundations, whose designer and builder is God. By faith, Sarah herself received power to conceive, even when she was past the age, since she considered him faithful who had promised. Therefore, from one man, and him as good as dead, were born descendants, as many as the stars of heaven, and as many as the innumerable grains of sand by the seashore. These all died in faith, not having received the things promised, but having seen them and greeted them from afar, and having acknowledged that they were strangers and exiles on the earth. For people who speak thus make it clear that they are seeking a homeland. If they had been thinking of that land from which they had gone out, they would have had opportunity to return. But as it is, they desire a better country, that is, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared for them a city. By faith, Abraham, when he was tested, offered up Isaac. And he who had received the promises was in the act of offering up his only son, of whom it was said, "Through Isaac shall your offspring be named." He considered that God was able even to raise him from the dead, from which, figuratively speaking, he did receive him back. By faith, Isaac invoked future blessings on Jacob and Esau. By faith, Jacob, when dying, blessed each of the sons of Joseph, bowing in worship over the head of his staff. By faith, at the end of his life, Joseph made mention of the Exodus and of the Israelites and gave directions concerning his bones. By faith, Moses, when he was born, was hidden for 3 months by his parents because they saw that the child was beautiful, and they were not afraid of the king's edict. By faith, Moses, when he was grown up, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to be mistreated with the people of God than to enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. He considered the reproach of Christ greater wealth than the treasures of Egypt, for he was looking to the reward. By faith, he left Egypt, not being afraid of the anger of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. By faith, he kept the Passover and sprinkled the blood so that the destroyer of the firstborn might not touch them. So far, the reading of God's word. Brothers and sisters, what a great privilege it is to be a member of the Church of Jesus Christ, to be a child of God. Now, in the past, I have had a question. Is it really such a privilege to belong to the church? Sometimes I have been ashamed of the church. Maybe you've had that same experience. Sometimes I have rather not been known as belonging to the church. It certainly doesn't increase one's status, does it, to belong to the church, one's status in this world. But brothers and sisters, confessing our faith in Christ entails identifying with God's people, being a member of his church. Now, we all know that confessing our faith in Christ is basic to our salvation. The Lord Jesus in Matthew 10 that we read plainly says that he will deny those who deny him, and he will acknowledge those, and God in heaven will acknowledge those who acknowledge him. And we all know that confessing Christ with our mouth, that Jesus is Lord, openly saying what we believe in our hearts, we know that's basic to our salvation. We confess that because we believe he is a living Savior. He is our Lord. We know that he suffered and died in our place. And he rose again as proof that we are right with God through faith in him. We know those things. But our text brings out one thing that we may not have given much thought to. Confessing our faith in Christ entails taking up the reproach of Christ. The reproach of Christ. Reproach means disgrace, shame, even being blameworthy. For Christ, it meant shame. It meant he was regarded by men and also by God as blameworthy. And he suffered the punishment of sin. And our text makes it clear that Moses understood that he must take up the reproach of Christ. And so must we. To take up the reproach of Christ means to identify with him and with his people and reject the ways of this world. I want us to consider that as we look at our text. And I read the text again, verses 24 to 26 of Hebrews chapter 11. By faith, Moses, when he was grown up, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to be mistreated with the people of God than to enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. He considered the reproach of Christ greater wealth than the treasures of Egypt, for he was looking to the reward. As we consider this taking up of the reproach of Christ, note first of all that it means rejecting the good life, put it in quotes, the good life offered by the world. Verse 24, Moses refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. Pharaoh's daughter is the one who had him retrieved out of the river, out of the Nile, when he was placed there in a basket by his mother. And she took him as her own son. And now Moses is grown up. He's 40 years old. And he makes the decision to refuse to be the son of Pharaoh's daughter, to refuse to be the prince of Egypt. And he took up the reproach of Christ by refusing that. He deliberately left his royal position and palace life. Now, why would anyone do such a thing? Take up a life of reproach, to be mocked, to be ignored, to be belittled, to be despised, to be persecuted, to be regarded as blameworthy. Why would anyone do that? He had so much, and he gave it all up. The answer has to be because he believed in God, and he believed God's word. He believed God's promise, and he knew that God's promises were made to Israel, the people of God, not to Egypt. He knew that, and he believed that. His parents believed in God and God's promises as well. They acted in faith, hiding him from Pharaoh. In faith, putting him in the river. In faith, then, when his mother became his nurse for Pharaoh's daughter, his mother no doubt would have told him the stories of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and how God had made promises to them and their descendants. He knew, as his mother had taught him, and as he understood from the word of God, which she recounted, that the promises of God were made to Israel. And so he said to Pharaoh's daughter, to his adoptive mother, he said, "I'm not any longer going to be your son. I'm leaving the palace. I'm going back to my people, to Israel." He was leaving all the wealth of Egypt. It was one of the great powers of the day. He was leaving the privilege and status that belonged to a prince of Egypt. He was leaving the possibility even of being future Pharaoh. And he left it all. You might think, "Moses, you could have helped God's people by staying in that position." Perhaps, at least humanly thinking, he could have. If he had become the Pharaoh, I suppose he could have set them free. But he knew that God's people received the promises of God, and those promises didn't have to do with Egypt, but with Canaan. And so he obeyed and he left it all. Now, as we think about this, of course, we realize that none of us is Moses and we aren't in his position. And yet we have the same God and the same promises. For some of us, taking up the reproach of Christ and rejecting the good life that this world offers might involve rather smaller things than Moses gave up. And yet we are called to do it. It might mean turning down a promotion at work so that you have time to serve in the church and care for your family. It might mean telling the coach you're not willing to play on the Lord's Day because that day you honor, and being put off the team as a result. For some in other countries today, it means being rejected by family, banished from the home, even losing your job, and enduring suffering. And that's just an illustration of the kinds of things that may be entailed in taking up the reproach of Christ and rejecting the good life that this world offers. Moses knew he must reject Egypt to love God. He knew what the Apostle John reminds us of in 1 John chapter 2. "Do not love the world or the things of the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him." Brothers and sisters, do not love the world. It's passing. But secondly, we see in verse 25 that taking up the reproach of Christ means identifying with God's people. We read there that Moses chose rather to be mistreated with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures and the benefits of being Pharaoh's grandson. Now, God has given his promises to his people as a body. And for this reason, confessing our faith entails joining with God's people and living as an active member of his body. God is gathering his people out of the world and into his church. By his Spirit, he opens their hearts to believe in his word and take hold of those promises that he has given to his people. And he joins them to Christ as members of the body of Christ, the church. And as such, then, we have been transferred, you see, out of the kingdom of this world into the kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Now, go back to Moses again. Moses, from an early age, lived in the palace. His life was bound up with Egypt. His future was apart from God's people, and therefore, apart from God's promises. His ancestor Joseph knew that those promises would be fulfilled in Canaan, and that's why Joseph requested that when he died, his bones would be carried back to that promised land. He believed the promise of God. And to share in the promise of God that was given to God's people, Moses joined them, casting his lot in with theirs, which wasn't a very appealing lot, mind you. They were slaves. Hard-worked slaves. God's people were despised, mistreated, maligned, and brutally enslaved. And Moses chose to identify with them. He chose rather to be mistreated with the people of God. You can just hear the Egyptians saying, "Ha ha, there goes big Moses. He's not very big now, is he? He's taken up with the slaves." And sadly, you can even hear some of God's people saying, "Who are you, Moses, to rule over us?" When Moses had stuck up for them. Now, he had acted on his own, and it wasn't right what he did. But you see, he was identifying with the people of God when he tried to protect one of them from his brutal slave master. And God's people rejected Moses. And we know that that wasn't the last time. Because as you read through the book of Exodus and Numbers, you see that Moses was often maligned and abused and rejected many, many times. And as a result of his wrong action, Moses had to flee. And he left Egypt and he went out into the desert and lived there 40 years. But it's very instructive that when God called him to go back to Egypt in order to lead God's people out of Egypt, Moses took leave of his father-in-law and he referred to the slaves in Egypt as my brothers. He hadn't forgotten his brothers. They were still regarded as his brothers, even though they had abused him And in this we see Moses being a type of Christ. Rejected by his people, and yet not ashamed to call them my brothers. Christ also suffered and was rejected by his own. He came to his own people, and they did not receive him, John tells us in the first chapter of John's Gospel. He was rejected by his own people. And yet, he called them my brothers. And so, brothers and sisters, even when we are ill-treated, not only by the world, but even by God's people, we are to regard them as my brothers. Christ also suffered for us, his brothers who had rejected him, his brothers who continue to sin against him, his brothers for whom he died in order that he might make them his own. But Moses' rejection by his people was used for God, by God for good. God prepared him not only with administrative training and the education of a royal person in Egypt, but now God was preparing him with a first-hand knowledge of the wilderness, through which, unbeknownst to him at the time, he would be called to lead God's people for 40 years. And so we must believe it is the same for us. Identification with God's people, even though it's not always pleasant, is for our good. God uses suffering and opposition to train us, to equip us, to purify us, to prepare us for heaven. So that we become more and more like our Savior, who was rejected by his own brothers and yet called them my brothers. Taking up the reproach of Christ means identifying with God's people even when we are mistreated by them. But thirdly, we see in verse 26, taking up the reproach of Christ means setting our eyes on the eternal reward. Why did Moses take up the reproach of Christ? Why did he refuse to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter? Why did he leave the riches of Egypt? Why did he identify with God's people and endure ill treatment with them and by them? Remember what he had? Wealth, status, position, a future. He was heir to the throne. He had a future. Moses had the good life. But he knew that that life was the broad road that leads to destruction. He knew that that life was only for a short time. It was just this life. And then it would end. He knew, like the Apostle Paul, that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which is to come for God's people. Moses' Moses knew that the things of this world actually will not satisfy our deepest longings. All the world's glitter turns out to be just that, glitter that passes away and is worth nothing in the end. He was looking for something much more valuable and much more lasting. He was looking to the reward. Now, some of you might have the NIV, and it says his reward there, but his isn't in there. He was looking to the reward that was promised to God's people. Not just Moses' reward, but the reward promised to God's people. He was looking for a better country, an eternal city built by God, of which he would be a part and enjoy with the people of God, the fellowship of God for all eternity and all the benefits and blessings of that promise that are entailed in it. The world calls to us still today, come on, you Christians, get a life. And we say, no thanks. The life that you promise is very short-lived and will not satisfy. The life that God has promised to his people is eternal and has benefits which we cannot imagine in store for us. God has promised us an eternal reward, a city which he himself has built and into which the riches of the kings of the earth will be brought, where there will be no more tears, no mourning, no death, no pain. That's why I say to the world, no thanks. And so, brothers and sisters, let us fix our eyes on the heavenly eternal reward God has promised to us, to all who confess his name. Let us continue to identify with the people of God and suffer the reproach of Christ that entails. Let us reject the pleasures this world offers, which do not satisfy and which in the end lead to eternal death. Let us walk the path of the saints of old, those recorded in Hebrews 11 and many others. Setting our minds on things above, taking up the reproach of Christ, who, as chapter 12 of Hebrews tells us, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Yes, consider him who endured from sinners such hostility against himself, so that you may not grow weary or faint-hearted. Shall we pray? Our Father in heaven, enable us to lift our eyes to heaven where Christ is, seated at your right hand. Enable us to comprehend more and more as we focus on him and his promise, the great work that you are doing in this world to build your church, to purify it, yes, and to beautify it. And so, Lord, keep us from ever being ashamed to be part of your church. Help us day by day to take up the reproach of Christ, to focus on him who is our Savior and our Lord, our risen and victorious King. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Turn in your Sing to the Lord books Now to number 495. And let us commit ourselves to our Lord, taking up the reproach of Christ and looking to the eternal reward. Now receive the benediction of our God. Now may the God of peace, who brought up again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, may he equip you with everything good, that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight. Through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. And as a doxology, we'll sing number 525, Now Unto Him.